In the previous lecture, I have seen what an analytic function means. Today, we will find the necessary condition for a function of a complex variable to be analytic. In fact, the necessary condition for a function of complex variable f of z to be analytic is that its real and imaginary parts must satisfy a particular mathematical condition. And what is that mathematical condition? In fact, the mathematical condition which must be satisfied for f of z to be analytic is known as Cauchy-Riemann condition. Actually, the real and imaginary part u and v of f of z satisfy a mathematical condition expressed in terms of first order partial derivatives, and those equations or those conditions are known as Cauchy-Riemann equation. So it means when you say Cauchy-Riemann equation or you want to know the necessary condition for a function f of z to be analytic, it means you are talking same thing. So whenever we are asked to state the condition of necessary condition for f of z to be analytic, or we are asked what is Cauchy-Riemann equation, it means the answer of both questions will be same. In short, you may say Cauchy-Riemann equation or Cauchy-Riemann condition is in fact the necessary condition for a function of a complex variable f of z to be analytic. Now, let us start to know what is this condition, that is the Cauchy-Riemann condition or the necessary condition for f of z to be analytic. For your convenience, I have just written the statement here, C. What is CR equation or what is the necessary condition for f of z to be analytic? The statement says that the necessary condition for a function f of z which is equal to u of xy plus I times v of xy to be analytic in a given region, suppose R, is what? The condition says this function f of z which is equal to u of xy plus I times v of xy is necessarily an analytic function if this condition is satisfied. That is, the condition is del u del x equal to del v del y, and simultaneously del u del y equal to minus del v del x. You see, u and v are real and imaginary part of f. So the real and imaginary parts of f of z, that is u and v, must satisfy these equations or these conditions to be analytic. And this condition will hold only when these partial derivatives, these four partial derivatives, that is del u del x, del u del y, del v del x and del v del y exist. In fact, this set of equation is known as CR equation, or you may say it CR condition. This is the statement. Now, at first, I would like to prove this statement. For its proof, the basic fundamentals already we have learnt in the previous lecture. That is, the independence of the derivative of an analytic function or a function of a complex variable f of z from the way in which the complex variable z changes. this fact will be utilized in the derivation of these CR equations. So let us now derive these relations, or let us know how we will prove these conditions. So what is the proof of CR equations, or the necessary condition for f of z to be analytic? Let us see the proof. We know that a function of a complex variable z, which is denoted by f, that is f of z, is equal to u of x y plus I times v of x y. It is well known to you. Here u is the real part and v is the imaginary part of the function f of z. Now see this equation. Here we see that this f of z depends on u and also on v. So whenever there will be a change in u and in v, definitely there will be a corresponding change in f of z. So let us say, if u is changed to u plus delta u, it means there is a change of delta u in u due to any cause, let us suppose, and v plus delta v, it means there is a change of delta v in v. If such change occurs, that is u becomes u plus delta u and v becomes v plus delta v, then the function f of z becomes, this function becomes, let us say, f of z plus delta z. We have assumed it. When u becomes u plus delta u, v becomes v plus delta v, then f of z becomes f of z plus delta z. So in the light of equation 1, what we may write? We may write in the light of equation 1 that f of z plus delta z, see above, when f of z becomes f of z plus delta z, then u becomes u plus delta u. So we must place u plus delta u at the place of u, and so it will be u plus delta u and plus I times of v plus delta v. Just I have written this equation in the light of equation 1. Let us say this is order 2 or equation number 2. Just we consider this equation number 2. Now let us subtract equation 1 from equation 2 and divide the result by delta z. From one and two, we may write, what we can write? we may write f of z plus delta z minus f of z over delta z equal to f plus delta z minus f of z. F of z plus delta z, c equation 2, that will be u plus delta u plus I times of v plus delta v, v plus delta v. And minus f of z, at the place of f of z we will place minus u plus iv, u plus iv. And as I have divided the LHS by delta z, so divide RHS 2 by delta z. This will be our result. Now let us see the simple algebra. You may see that this u and iv will cancel out. And we are left behind the result delta u plus I times of delta v over delta z. You may write it by dividing delta z separately. We will have delta u over delta z plus I times of delta v over delta z. Now let us take a limiting condition that this delta z is tending towards 0. When delta z tends to 0, what you will get? We will write simply, this is limit delta z tends to 0 f of z plus delta z minus f of z over delta z, and this will be equal to, take the same limit in RHS 2, limit delta z tends to 0 and delta u over delta z plus I times of delta v over delta z. Just a simple calculation. This is very easy to understand. Now, when in my second lecture, when I was discussing the differentiability of a function of a complex variable, you have seen that this is in fact nothing. This is simply the derivative of f of z with respect to z. So we may write this expression as simply what? This is df DZ. And in Leibniz symbol, you may write it as, this is just equivalent, F prime of Z. And this will be equal to what? This is equal to limit delta Z tending towards 0 delta U over delta Z plus I times of delta V over delta Z. Let us say this is equation 3. Now, I have already mentioned in previous lecture that this derivative of f of z is independent of the manner in which z changes. That is, how z changes, it does not matter. If z changes by several manners or several paths, the change, the derivative f dashed of z will be same. So let us now utilize this important property of the derivative of a function of a complex variable. We will utilize this very property in this section, and you will see that utilizing such a property, we will get our desired result. As I have told that f dashed of z is independent of the path or the manner or the method in which you bring a change in z. For simplicity, here we take only two paths or two manners in by which z will change, and in those two methods we will find the value of f dashed of z. But you know the values found for f dashed of z by varying z in two different manners will not be different. The values of f dashed of z will be same. So let us consider the first way to change the value of z. Let us consider the first way of changing of z, which will lead to change in x and y too. This, let us say this is x axis, or you may say it a real axis. This is y axis, or you may say it imaginary axis. The first path or the first method which I am going to take for the variation of z, let us say it is along x-axis or real axis. Along x-axis or real axis. X-axis or real axis. As you know, z is equal to what? Z is simply equal to x plus iy. It is very evident to us that z equal to x plus iy. But when we consider that we have a tendency to change z by moving ourselves along x-axis. So if we consider two points on x-axis, let us say this is a point P and this is another point Q, and here at P z is equal to z, and at Q z is equal to z plus delta z, let us say. But along x-axis, along x-axis, when we will move along x-axis. What will be y? Y will be 0. And if y is 0, then what will be z? See the above equation. As when we move along x-axis, y is 0, so z will be equal to x. Z equal to x. And this implies, if z is equal to x, this implies delta z will be equal to delta x. And simultaneously, you also may say that as y is 0, so delta y is equal to 0. Delta y is equal to 0. Now let us substitute these values in equation number 3. In equation number 3, we will substitute these values. What we will get when we will substitute these values in equation number 3? Let us see. So, from 3, the result which we will got on substituting these values in equation 3 will be what? In fact, that will be f dashed of z. F dashed of z will be equal to, f dashed of z will be equal to limit. There is delta, there is condition delta z tends to 0, but as I have shown that delta z in this condition is equal to delta x. So our condition will be limit delta x tends to 0. Delta u by delta x plus I times of delta v by delta x. So what you get if we impose the limiting condition on both of these terms? What will be our result? The result will be simply f dashed of z is equal to limit delta x tends to 0 delta u by delta x. That will be simply du dx plus I times of del v del x. Say it is equation number 4. See, we have obtained the value of f dashed of z in a particular condition when we change z by a proper manner, by changing x but keeping the y fixed at its 0 value. This is one of the manners. Manners may be different. Now let us consider the another manner by which we will bring a change in z. In this second manner, let us consider to move along y-axis. This is x-axis. This is y-axis or imaginary axis. And now take the point P and Q on y-axis. Let us say at point P, z is z, and at Q, it is z plus delta z. So when we will move along y-axis, or imaginary axis, then what will be our result? As z equal to x plus iy, we know it, and along y-axis, what will be x? X will be 0. So if x is 0, see this expression, then z will be equal to what? This will be simply iy. And if z equal to iy, what will be delta z? Delta z, as I is constant, so I times of delta y. So in this condition, delta z is equal to I times of delta. And simultaneously, since x is 0, so we may take delta x equal to 0. Now let us substitute these conditions or these values in the same equation 3, as we have substituted the value in first manner in equation 3. Let us again put these values in equation number 3. See the equation number 3 and substitute that these values in that equation. Let us see here. This is equation number 3. We will replace delta z in this equation by I delta y, and delta z inside the terms in bracket, again I delta y. So there will be a simple replacement of delta z by I delta y in equation 3 when we have to substitute the values obtained in the last equation. So let us substitute and see the result. So from equation 3, what we will get? We will get that f dashed of z is equal to limit I times of delta y tending towards 0. Let us see here, delta z has been replaced by I delta y, and delta u over I delta y. Delta z here is also replaced by I delta y, and plus I times of delta v over I times of delta y. Let us see the simple algebra. Here this I and I will cancel out, and since I is a constant factor, so when I delta y tends to 0, you may say that delta y tends to 0, because I never tends to 0. I has a fixed value, you know, this is a square root of minus 1, so it never tends to 0, it has a fixed value. So this condition refers that when you say I times of delta y tends to 0, what does it mean? It means simply delta y is tending towards 0. So let us take this limiting condition as limit delta y tends to 0. Now write the second term inside the bracket first. Here we will write, this is delta v over delta y. And see the first term, here is a factor 1 over I, and you know 1 over I is minus I. So this will be minus I times of delta u over delta y. Now, in accordance with the definition of derivatives, what you can write the RHS of this equation? In fact, we can write it as when this limiting condition will be imposed on both of the terms separately, what will be our result? Our result will be del v over del y minus I del u over del y. Let us say this is equation 5. So see, we have considered two manners of variation of z. The first manner was that we have changed the value of x keeping the y constant. The second manner is what? This is in fact we change z by changing y keeping the value of x fixed at 0. And in both of these cases, we have obtained the same quantity, that is f dashed of z, which means derivative of the function of complex variable f with respect to z. We have obtained the same derivative. As I have told in previous lectures and in this present lecture too, that this derivative f dashed of z, it is in fact independent of the path or manner, you may say it manner by which a change is brought in z. Value of f dashed of z, that is the derivative of f of z with respect to z, does not depend on the fact that how you change z. In fact, this manner or path does not matter. So we can say that the values of f dashed of z defined in equation 4 and 5 will be same. So from 4 and 5, the values of derivatives f dashed of z will be same. And so we may equate these two values. After equating, what will be our result? The result will be del u del x, see equation 4 above, plus I del v del x, and this will be equal to what? This will be equal to this much. This is del v del y minus I times of del u del y. As you know, when two complexes are equal, then the real part of the first complex is equal to real part of the second complex, and similarly the imaginary part of the first complex is equal to imaginary part of the second complex. So equating the real and imaginary part of these two complexes, what will be our result? Equating real and imaginary parts. What we will get? We will get, when you equate real part, let us see here, del u del x will be equal to del v del y. Del u del x equal to del v del y. And equating the imaginary part, what we will get? This will be, in fact, del v del x equal to minus del u del x. I is common factor. So you may equate the imaginary part and get the result. Let us write first del u del y. And that will be equal to what? Minus del v del x. Let us see. In fact, this set of equation is known as what? As I have stated in the statement, these are in fact CR equation, that is Cauchy-Riemann equation or Cauchy-Riemann condition. So these are CR condition or Cauchy-Riemann equation or condition. You may say equation or condition both. So these are the CR equations. In fact, we see that these equations provide the necessary condition for f of z to be analytic. Actually, you can say that if f is analytic in an open set R, then CR equation must hold at every point of R. Just for your convenience, I write down this short statement that if f is analytic, f is analytic in an open set or region, you may say it region, open set R, then the CR equations must hold at every point of R. Every point of R. I think you have clearly understand all the steps in proving the CR condition or CR equation. So these are CR equation, in fact, in Cartesian coordinate. You must remember it. Today, I am just stopping my lecture at this point after derivation of the CR equation. And in next lecture, we will see what is the sufficient condition of f of z to be analytic. But remember, when you will attend the second lecture, the concepts of the first lecture must be in your mind. So go through this lecture seriously and then you will enjoy the second lecture.